Hello everyone and welcome back, and hi if you are new here. Today's video is on women who have killed their husbands. I have a lot more cases covering this topic, so let me know if you want a part 2. I was going to cover notorious criminals from around the world, so comment a state or a place you would like me to cover. I hope you enjoyed today's video and stay tuned for more. Number 1. Marjorie Orbin. Before Marjorie and Jay started dating, she had already been married 7 times. Marjorie wanted a jet-set lifestyle and an endless supply of money and glamour. After a short amount of time dating, they finally got married. Married life was good for a few years. Marjorie stayed home and cooked and cleaned, and they were finally able to have a child, as Marjorie was told when she was just 18 years old she could not have children. On August 24th, 2004, Jay and Marjorie celebrated Noah's 8th birthday with some friends and family. After the celebration, Jay left to go on a business trip to Florida. However, he had to return as Hurricane Francis made the journey too dangerous. On September 8th, 2004, Joanne Orbin called her son Jay to wish him happy birthday. He told her he was driving back home to Phoenix and would call her later that night. She never received a call. Weeks passed, and the mom still had not heard anything. But Marjorie insisted that there was nothing to worry about, and Jay just went on another business trip. However, when Jay was traveling, he still found time to call. Another week went by, and Jay's family and friends urged Marjorie to report him missing. Marjorie finally reported him missing. Her police asked for just some standard and basic details to assist in their search, such as Jay's license plate number. And Marjorie told them she would call them back, and she never.
Police had to leave 3 messages before Marjorie finally called them back. The detective recorded the phone call, and I will leave a link below. She's very heated and very tense on the phone call.
While Jay was missing, Marjorie had already moved in with her new boyfriend,
Larry,
into their home. He even used some of Jay's closet space for his own clothes. Marjorie didn't help search for Jay and did not assist police with investigation. Instead, she drained out Jay's bank account, and she bought a $12,000 baby grand piano and took out $45,000 from Jay's business account. Marjorie's activities and her reluctancy to help police caused police to be concerned that they were dealing with more than just a missing persons case. They obtained a warrant to search the Orbin home. They found Jay's credit cards and his business checkbook in the house. There were items that Jay always took with him when going away on business. Jay's cell phone records and credit card statements revealed he had actually returned from Phoenix to Florida, but where he went after that wasn't clear. On 23rd of October 2004, a man found a container wrapped in heavy black plastic in North Phoenix. When he opened the container, he discovered a torso. Police looked inside the 50-gallon Rubbermaid container and found a torso, a wad of cash, and a single spent bullet. All of the insides and internal organs and intestines were missing. Police discovered that the body had been frozen after death and was dismembered using a saw. There were no other body parts found, so police used DNA testing to identify the victim. The victim was, in fact, Jay Orbin. Just 3 weeks after Jay's body was found, Marjorie was caught forging Jay's signature at a Circuit City store. On the 6th of December, 6 weeks after her husband's dismembered body was discovered, the state charged Marjorie with first-degree murder, 2 counts of theft, and 2 counts of fraudulent schemes. It was the prosecution's case that Marjorie killed Jay on the 8th of September 2004 because she wanted him out of her life and wanted his money. That's why they believed she dumped his torso so close to their home. They believed that she wanted it to be found so she could receive the life insurance payout in the estate of Jay. It was their case that Marjorie shot Jay in the garage of his home, froze his body, and used 2 jigsaw blades to cut him into pieces. They believed the jigsaw blade was used because the cuts through Jay's tibia in the vertebrae were consistent with being made by a jigsaw. After she killed Jay, Marjorie cleaned the garage. Police found receipts of mops and cleaning products, which were bought just 1 day after Jay was missing. They believed that she acid washed the garage floor and then painted the floor. This erased all traces of blood. Just 2 days after Jay first went missing, surveillance footage from Lowe's hardware store showed Marjorie buying 2 containers. She bought them with Jay's credit card. Marjorie was convicted for murder, and she was given a life sentence by the court. She had claimed that her former lover, Larry, had committed the crime, but he made a deal for immunity and testified against her. The rest of Orbin's body has never been found. Jay's brother, Jake, got custody of Noah after the murder conviction.
Number 2. Stacy Castor. Stacy Castor married her first husband, Mike Wallace, in 1988. The couple seemed perfectly happy together and had 2 daughters, Ashley and Bree. Stacy worked during the day as an ambulance dispatcher and Michael worked a night shift as a mechanic, meaning they'd spend little time together as a couple. Working such different hours ended up putting a strain on Stacy and David, and they often found themselves arguing and clashing. Michael was a heavy drinker, which Stacy openly admitted she didn't like. And this too, along with his favoritism toward their youngest daughter, Bree, caused strain on their marriage. There were also rumors of mutual affairs between the couple and that Stacy was preparing to approach Michael with regards of getting a divorce. In 1999, the couple were still very much together, although the marriage continued to be strained. Michael began suffering with various health problems, including chest problems, sickness, and skin imbalance issues, as well as headaches. The concerned family urged him to see a doctor who believed that Michael was suffering from inner ear issues. Michael's health continued to decline over the festive period and into January of the new year. On the 11th of January, Stacy was working her day shift whilst Michael was at home with their oldest daughter, Ashley. It was this afternoon that Michael's health took a further turn for the worst, and he was discovered unresponsive in the living room by Ashley, who alerted emergency services. Michael was rushed to the hospital, but was sadly pronounced dead on arrival. Despite having been unwell for some time and young in age, doctors concluded that Michael had passed away due to a sudden heart attack, and stated that they would not be performing an autopsy, meaning that the family could go ahead and make funeral arrangements. This also meant that Stacy was able to claim $55,000 in life insurance that was set up in the event of Michael's passing. Her second husband. In 2001, Stacy met David Castor through her boss at work. The pair hit it off quickly and began dating. David had a son from a previous marriage. Despite being a father already, David did not take kindly to Stacy's daughters and made it clear that he would never look upon them as being his own. He was strict with them and expected them to do as they were told at all times, which they very much resented. The girls' feelings toward David were mutual, with them viewing him as wanting to replace their beloved late father. Despite these discrepancies, Stacy and David went on to marry in 2003. The couple had 2 years of a fairly happy marriage before things began to get rocky, with them arguing frequently and clashing over various issues. On August 22, 2005, Stacy called 911 from work, panicking. She informed the operator that her husband had failed to show up to work that day. She told them she had last seen them at 5 a.m. that morning in their home, heading to their bedroom after an argument. Stacy said that David had been carrying a bottle of Southern Comfort with him into the room and that he had locked her out, refusing to speak with her. She said that as she left for work a few hours later, she could hear him through the door snoring and assumed he was just sleeping off his hangover, and that they patched things up later that day. When police arrived at the Castors' home, they had to break down the still-locked bedroom door, and upon entering the room, they were met with the sight of David Castor laying face down on the bed, quite clearly having passed away. There were 2 glasses on the nightstand next to the bed, one containing juice, and then another contained what looked like antifreeze. Under the bed, There was also an open bottle of antifreeze within reach of David, and it had appeared that he had taken his own life. The property was sealed off and searched, with the cause of death becoming suspicious, with the finding of a turkey baster in the kitchen dustbin. It had appeared to have traces of alcohol in it. Stacy was adamant that David had killed himself, telling the police that he had been suffering from depression since losing his own father a few months prior. However, his family and his friends were certain this was not the case. More suspicions were raised when it became clear that David had left everything in his will to Stacy and her daughters. With the suspicions growing, detectives began to look into the background of Stacy's first marriage to Michael Wallace and his sudden death. Despite Castor telling them that Michael had suffered from numerous health problems, police found that the most severe medical issue he ever had experienced before his death was a hernia. This spurred them on to arrange for Michael's body to be exhumed and have an autopsy carried out. If their theory was correct, they would find that his organs would be crystallized due to the antifreeze poisoning.
Their theory was correct,
and Stacy Castor was brought in for questioning regarding the death of both of her husbands. During her interview on the 7th of September, Stacy freely answered questions. However, she found herself tripping up when she was asked about the glasses that were on the nightstand in the bedroom. When she was shown a photograph, she pointed at one of the glasses and said, "That is the glass I poured the cranberry juice into."
The detectives caught her out and pulled her up on this mistake,
but accused the detectives of trying to frame her and refused to continue the interview. Before her refusal to speak to anyone, it was also noticed that Stacy pronounced antifreeze as rather odd, with her referring it to anti-free. When Stacy's oldest daughter, Ashley Wallace, was informed that her father's death had been to poisoning rather than a heart attack, she was quite understandably shaken. She called Stacy to discuss the news. Little known to Stacy, the phone had been tapped by police in order to gain further information on the case. Stacy told Ashley to calm down and to come home where they could both enjoy a drink after their hard day. Ashley recalls drinking with her mother and finding the drink far too strong for her. She said that she had a couple drinks and then fell into bed, waking the next day feeling unwell and hungover. She went to school as usual and then arrived home to Stacy asking if she fancied having more drinks to celebrate her 21st birthday early. Ashley agreed once again, but struggled to drink the cocktails, telling Stacy they tasted unpleasant. In response to this, Stacy gave Ashley a straw and just told her to put it to the back of her throat and drink it anyway, so she wouldn't have to taste it but could still get drunk. Again, after an evening of drinking together, they went to bed. The next morning, Bree, the younger of the two girls, went to her sister's bedroom to wake her up. She found Ashley barely breathing and screamed to her mother to call 911 immediately. There was a note next to Ashley on the bed that had been typed, written, and signed off by her, claiming that she was behind the deaths of both her father and her stepfather. The letter was stated that she was so guilt-ridden by her crime she could no longer go on and intended to take her own life. She was rushed to hospital where, thanks to great efforts by the medical staff, she was stabilized. If it was 15 minutes later, she would have died too. She had been given a concoction of drugs and alcohol, which created her to be poisoned. When she came round, she was met with an array of people around her, including detectives who wanted to question her with regards to admissions which she made in the letter. The webs began to untangle, Ashley adamantly denying any involvement in the crimes and telling detectives that she had absolutely no intentions of taking her life and that she hadn't typed suicide note out. The last thing she could remember was going to bed after drinking with her mother days prior. After the admission from her daughter, Stacy Castor was promptly arrested and taken into custody and charged with murder and attempted murder, as well as forgery, relating to David Castor's will. She was sentenced to 51 years in prison on the 5th of March, 2009. She would never see her daughters again. Stacy Castor continuously professed her innocence, and she said she would never confess to killing her husbands and trying to pin it on her daughter by attempting to kill her too. She died in prison in 2016 due to natural causes, and she had never admitted to her vile crimes.
Well, that is the end of today's video. I really hoped you liked it. It is a bit different. I covered two cases, so let me know what you think. It would be amazing if you subscribed and liked this video and also followed my Instagram. Thank you so much, and I will see you in the next video.